talk back. In recent years, we have been talking a great deal about the importance of biodiversity. To discuss the linkages between the WTO and biodiversity, I have with me here today Dr. Suman Sahai, President Gene Campaign. Welcome, Suman. Now tell me, for our viewers, what exactly should a common man understand by biodiversity?
Biodiversity is essentially the great diversity in all forms of life, whether it's people or elephants or wheat plants or mango trees or bacteria or virus or fungus, any living thing. The diversity of all living things is biodiversity.
And why is it important for us to conserve biodiversity?
Because it is the foundation of life. Because if we have a broad base of biodiversity, then our options in agriculture, in medicine, in healing, in all kinds of economic activity are ensured. The broader our base, the more our choices, the more sustainable our options. So if we start slashing at our biodiversity, we are limiting our options for tomorrow.
It's such an obvious thing to preserve for a nation. Why is it that we've really been talking about it only for the past 6-7 years and not much before that?
There's a very good reason for that. The reason is the emergence of the intellectual property rights regime on biodiversity. I mean, why is it that in the WTO, the whole patent system has become such a flashpoint? The reason is that in the 1986 Uruguay round, for the first time we started talking about patenting biodiversity. The moment that started to happen, the people who have been working with biodiversity, developing countries who are in many senses the owners of biodiversity, became very concerned, and I think rightly so, and said that if you start having privatization, then you must talk about the other aspect, primarily conservation, to make sure that biodiversity doesn't get the kind of rotten deal that was threatening out of a very polarized IPR regime in the WTO.
See, on the one hand, you had the TRIPS, the intellectual property rights regime in the WTO, but then at the same time, you had the convention on biodiversity.
Correct.
Now, why these two things simultaneously and on parallel track? I mean, do they converge? Do they meet? What are the conflicts?
No, I think the important thing is that they should meet, and many in civil society and academia are concerned that they're actually diverging rather than converging. And the point is that it is possible to use biodiversity sustainably, and it is also possible to reward innovation without going to either extreme of saying no IPR at all or saying hands off from biodiversity, which is tending to be the tenor of the debate now. But yes, the fact that the CBD emerged as such a strong parallel treaty has to do with the fact that the TRIPS was emerging. Because TRIPS started to make all these demands on biodiversity and corporations began to enter the game of wanting to privatize biodiversity, that it was important to start establishing conservation goals primarily. Number one, you can't kill the goose that is laying the golden egg for all of us in the world. Let's not forget that biodiversity is the basis of sustainable life in the whole world. So there is a connection. The unfortunate thing is that they are not moving in the same direction. Whereas the TRIPS is enforcing patenting and privatization of biodiversity, many of the convention's modalities are not being acted on.
And this is all of us. By the convention modalities are not.
For example, what does the CBD, the Convention on Biological Diversity, what does it attempt to establish? What are its main objectives and what does it require? Primarily conservation, because I think that any person will admit that conservation has to be at the foundation of any use of biodiversity.
But to what exactly are the duties of the convention?
The requirements. I mean, what does the CBD require? What does it ask of member countries?
Like?
What it requires is that countries must establish sovereignty, which is, as I was saying, that it rectifies a historical wrong. Because unlike other natural resources like oil and minerals, etc., biological resources, which have always been a very important economic resource, have never been given ownership of the nations where they were found. So I think one thing that the CBD does, and this is directly related to the TRIPS question, that if you want to patent, then let us figure out and let us now clarify who are the owners of biodiversity. The other thing that it requires is acknowledgement that who are actually the people who have developed and maintained biodiversity, who are the people who have the knowledge of its use, who have the wisdom the indigenous knowledge of biodiversity, and the fact that these are local communities in all countries, that this must be acknowledged. And I think very importantly, it must be acknowledged by all members that if you use biodiversity from any country, then you have to go through a proper procedure, and you must also share the benefits of commercial exploitation with the communities whose knowledge you are using and who have been the custodians of the bioresources or the biodiversity. So these are, I think, primarily what, apart from conservation, which is foremost, what the CBD requires.
And under TRIPS in the WTO, as I understand it, there is scope for renegotiating, and not renegotiating, but reviewing some of these aspects of traditional knowledge and patenting.
So what's happening, Isha, right now is that for the initial period, from the time that the Uruguay round started in 86 till the establishment of the WTO and after that, there has been a very great deal of focus on what the TRIPS has demanded. Even our government, all governments, have neglected the CBD in a mystifying way, and have gone ahead with TRIPS requirements. Whereas what should have been done in a balanced way is to proceed on both. Clearly, the CBD is a very developing country-friendly treaty because it acknowledges the sovereignty, it acknowledges the rights of communities who have for thousands of years been working. So we should have proceeded on both.
But that's perhaps because CBD is not really ratified by the US.
That is precisely the reason. The most unfortunate reason why biodiversity is getting a beating globally is because of the fact that the single most powerful nation, the United States, has refused to ratify it. And the reason why that has happened is because its biotechnology industry has held back the government. You cannot have somebody being really a promotory of conservation, of environment, of biodiversity, human rights, the rights of communities, and then refuse to ratify this one major treaty that acknowledges all this. It's a very unfortunate development, and I hope that this will be rethought and that the Americans will enter this game and we can proceed in a much more sustainable way in treating the whole subject of biodiversity. You can have reward for innovators who are saying no, but you must acknowledge who are the actual owners and who are the actual people who have the indigenous knowledge.
But from our own point of view, Suman, do you really believe that biotechnology can offer many more options to our farmer for Indian agriculture, for example? Are we at that point where there are new frontiers opening, or are we still far away from that point?
Let me answer it this way. I think biotechnology as a science has much to offer. Biotechnology is not restricted only to agriculture.
Correct.
In the field of agriculture, I think the question is open. Today, the science is untested, untried, and still very, very immature. The unfortunate thing in biotechnology has been, and that has led to the polarization that you're seeing now, the ones who are saying it's all right are as wrong as the ones who are saying it's all wrong. Today, there is undoubtedly a lot of problem with the science itself. There is undoubtedly a horrific amount of problem associated with the way the science is being practiced. And at the core of this resistance is the fact that it is five multinational corporations, these giants who are controlling this technology. If this technology had still been in the university rather than in corporations, it would not be in the field.
So the feeling is that these multinational corporations are really driving science in a certain direction?
In this field, yes.
And would you say that's as much true for breakthroughs for agriculture as for pharmaceuticals? Or there is more apprehension for agriculture?
There is more apprehension for agriculture for a very basic reason. And I think that agriculture is a very emotive issue, and it touches the lives of many people. But I think primarily if you look at the science, what is dangerous is the flow of foreign genes. You know, it's like bad words which are spoken, you can never get them back. Genes that escape into the environment could land in all sorts of places. And that's the reason why I was saying the science is immature. Today, it is still an open question whether this will develop into a science which will actually address the needs of the poor and vulnerable, whether it will address the needs of humanity, or whether it, as it is doing today, it will only address the needs of the corporate sector. The target of research in the multinational concerns is very much commercial agriculture, very much a very limited kind of scope. That scope will have to increase, the science will have to be cleaned up, the policy will have to be much more equitable.
But even if you keep the corporate sector out, as you know, even when we talk of the green revolution and the high-yielding varieties that we adopted, you know, for wheat and rice, there is so much, you know, opposition by some green sort of NGOs because they feel that this has really not been good for our biodiversity.
Well, you know, I think that one has to be extremely self-critical also, and always subscribing to the lunatic fringe does not necessarily take the green agenda further, and we must always keep in mind that the green agenda must be taken further because therein lies our collective interest. So it's always best to remain factual and best to remain balanced in the arguments. Be as critical as you like, but remain within the realms of truth. I think that to answer your question about whether the Green Revolution is working against biodiversity, the answer is yes. The question is that the attractive benefit of high yield, which the high-yielding varieties brought, to a certain extent unsustainably, but they brought that, is so attractive that farmers will opt for it. And therefore, the great number of varieties that were being grown in the field will be restricted, as has been happening. There is no question that this has been happening. The point is, the challenge is, how can we continue to increase food production and how can we continue to retain as much genetic diversity in the field as possible? This is a complex challenge. Simple black and white answers cannot be the answers. They will have to be complex answers.
On the one hand, you have all the economic benefits that we have seen as a country since 1970 of, you know, better yields of food grains. But on the other hand, we also have this, you know, pest resistance.
You also have ecological degradation.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, I mean, the Punjab, which has gone in for rice production and which has gone in for three crop production, has shown. You know, you can't abuse nature beyond a point. You have to give nature a chance and an opportunity to recover and recoup. Nature can take quite a beating, but if you overdo it, then it becomes unsustainable. And that's what the Green Revolution has done. Now, after having recognized that there was a downside, we should have started being corrective. Our failure has been that we didn't do it. Not that the Green Revolution per se was an evil, monstrous design of some kind, but the fact is that we have to find a way in which we can continue to produce. And if there are better ways of doing it, then we must explore those better ways. The fact is that you can combine the goals of food production and retaining genetic diversity. My organization, we've been conducting a study in UP and Bihar for a year now, and we're continuing that to try and understand what the farmer's perception of loss of diversity is. Because there's very little point for us sitting in hallowed rooms and saying genetic diversity is getting lost and we have to do something about it. The farmer must respond. The farmer will ultimately be the carrier of whether we will conserve diversity.
And what do you find?
It's a very complex and mixed response. Of course, in rain-fed areas where farmers have not had access to high-yielding varieties, that is such a desirable goal. That yield advantage is such a desirable goal. How can you not understand that? Yes. On the other hand, farmers that have been the beneficiaries of intensive agricultural practices and that are actually seeing the ecological degradation in their fields are now beginning to understand that there is a downside to it. But I think that the complex responses of the farmers reflects the complexity of the problem. You want the yield advantage, but you also want to have a secure and healthy production system with your field, with your water and your land. So I think that a combination of conservation strategies linked to the farm, linked to gene banks, a conservation strategy that will be inclusive of farmers and take into account their cooperation will certainly be able to achieve these twin goals.
Is our national policy moving in that direction?
Unfortunately, no. Not as much as it should. The formal agricultural system is still only looking at the Green Revolutionary model. The formal agricultural system has not as yet truly internalized and responded to the downside. It has to do that, because undoubtedly genetic diversity is the foundation. Let us not forget one thing, that all of the gains that we have achieved in agriculture across the world have only been possible because we have had access to a very large genetic diversity.
But to some extent you do need a national campaign, because you can't wait for farmers in different regions to learn by doing, you know,
surely,
first gain.
Surely.
So what is happening on that front?
Well, I know Gene campaign is such a campaign, but I think we are trying to also sensitize policymakers, and there is an increasing awareness. It would be not fair to say that there is an absolute obtuse attitude on this. There is now the setting up of a national biodiversity board. Some states have set up state diversity boards, which are also looking at some of these questions. And I think that the government alone should not be left with this responsibility. By all means, government will have to have a policy direction in this, but I think that the job will actually be executed by many outside as well. The NGO community will be a very big player.
How do we compare with other developing countries in terms of efforts to conserve their biodiversity at the national government level, let's say?
I would say that all developing countries have a reasonably rotten record on conservation. And all developing countries have a very sensitized civil society which is attempting to work oftentimes with government. The direction is moving towards conservation goals. The direction is moving towards an understanding that long term there can be no way of bypassing conservation of biodiversity. Legislation is moving to strengthen that. India itself is in the process of bringing a biodiversity legislation.
But we've been talking about it for...
We've been talking about it because in our political system, we rush to the well when there's Babri, we rush to the well when there's the Helka, we rush to the well at all sorts of opportunities, and rushing to the well is not the most productive way of conducting parliamentary proceedings when the function of parliament is to enact law and legislation. So I think that we need to be very responsible. But the intentions are definitely moving in the right direction.
What is the biggest challenge facing our biodiversity in the years ahead?
I think the biggest challenge facing at the global level, facing biodiversity, is the is whether we will have the ability to ensure sustainable use and long-term use on the one hand. That means you continue to use. I'm not in favor of a hands-off approach. It's not a sacred thing that you have to put away. But how do we combine the commercial exploitation of biodiversity in a sustainable way and build into it the equity and justice that is a moral component of this exploitation? And I think one of the most threatening institutionalized challenges to biodiversity is the TRIPS regime, the way it exists today. The TRIPS review process is on. It is imperative that biodiversity concerns are brought on board. It is very heartening to see that India is now moving in that direction. The Organization of African Unity is moving in that direction. There is an attempt to bring into the TRIPS review process the linkage between biodiversity convention and the TRIPS so that we are moving in a much more balanced way. That is absolutely necessary.
Are you hopeful?
Yes. Yes, I am hopeful. I am hopeful that ultimately the conservation angle, the ownership angle, the benefit sharing angle will have to be taken on board, because it's such a blatantly unfair situation right now that I don't think you can really morally sustain it.
So this is one set of issues, but the other of course is the whole approach towards biotechnology, the approach towards science as we look for more options in agriculture. And as you know, the Europeans are very resistant to the genetically modified, you know, options and all. Why do you think that there is so much resistance in Europe to this biotechnology for agriculture? And what does it mean for us? Should we be apprehensive?
See, I think the science itself today, the science of GM crops, is immature. There are very serious reservations right now that will have to be cleaned up. But the process of research is precisely that.
But take the case of this famous golden rice. Yeah. Now, would you tell us where it stands today? On the one hand, we hear that, you know, it has vitamin A and various, you know, other nutritional, you know, benefits that will come.
Yeah.
But then it isn't quite ready, and people have some apprehensions about what other sort of fallouts
it
come out
have.
Of that.
I think that if GM research should go in any direction, then it should not go in the direction of BT cotton. It should go in the direction of golden rice, because at least golden rice is a research direction which attempts to address the needs of the poor, which means night blindness and vitamin A deficiency. We also know that it is only one of many technologies or strategies that will be used and that which will be effective.
What stage is it at today?
It's still experimental. It's not in the field. It's certainly not being grown anywhere. It will still take some time for it to become a crop variety that can be safely released in the field.
And you mentioned not in the direction of BT cotton. Would you?
I mean, BT cotton, excuse me, is something that is designed to benefit Monsanto. There are many approaches to disease resistance. In fact, there's this fantastic study in China.
What is BT cotton?
BT cotton is genetically modified cotton which contains a gene which was derived from a bacterium. A bacterium called Bacillus thuringiensis. Mm-hmm. B for Bacillus, T for thuringiensis, BT cotton.
Okay.
Contains a bacterial gene. The point is that when you have a crop that is designed to address the needs of the poor, there'll be much greater acceptance than when you have a crop that is designed to benefit the corporation that is releasing it. In the case of why is Europe, to go back to your question, why is Europe resistant to GM crops? There's a very fundamental reason which has got nothing to do with science. The reason is, in the European perception, after the BSE scandal and the scandal that happened with the chemical contamination of animal feed, the European people do not trust their governments. If you recall, during the mad cow disease, the British government continued to say that it is safe for humans, that it is only a disease that will affect cows, and that human beings are creating too much of a fuss, that the green groups are not being factual. This has got nothing to do with people.
And now, of course, you have this foot and mouth disease.
No, then you had immediately the Jakob Creutzfeldt disease, which is mad cow disease in humans, and you were able to show that the transmission of this disease into human beings came from the mad cows. Now, if I am being told by my government consistently that there is no way that human beings can be affected, there is no way this infection can be transmitted, and then lo and behold, it happens, I'm not going to trust that government. That's what's happening in
but
Europe.
But tell me, today, in this day and age, if that's happening in Europe, you would think that even Americans would be sensitive to that, saying that if this is happening there, it could happen in America.
Should
you
we?
Don't have to be...
But let me tell you one thing.
Yeah.
You asked me why is Europe doing it.
Yes.
And I think that this is a very interesting question. The reason is that there is a difference in the way the Americans have handled the whole question of science and the way the Europeans have handled it.
Not because the Europeans are second in the race and therefore...
No. When genetic engineering, the science which allows biotechnology in agriculture, when genetic engineering matured as a science, the Americans very wisely, the scientists, very wisely held a series of conferences which became known as the Asilomar conferences, in which they came clean with the public. They told the public, this is the science, this is what we can do with it, this is as far as we go, these are the directions of research. I'm simplifying, but so the public has confidence that their policymakers will come clean. That confidence is clearly lacking in Europe because in the perception of the public, demonstrably, their governments have lied to them. It's all safe till it blows in your face and it's not safe. That is one reason. And I think the other reason, it's a very important reason, one mustn't underestimate it. I think the other reason is the fact that there is no real great compulsion to look for yet another crop variety and yet another way of producing wheat and yet another way of producing rice. So that's a second important reason. And I think the third important reason is that in Europe, which is a very politically sensitized society, very aware of rights, very aware of individual rights, this whole thing, the whole corporatization of the economy, the whole globalization process, which is removing choice. Let me give you an example. The smaller seed industries have been bought up. Now, your attitude in Europe, you can see, is that, you know, everybody should have a shot at it. Everybody should have a break. Everybody should be able to set up their little seed store. And why is it not happening? Why is it all moving into two hands? So the erosion of choices, the what they see as a striking of individual rights, in the sense that more and more rights are going into very, very big conglomerations, that is also somewhere an important player in why they are resisting.
Coming back to India, we repeatedly hear that we have tremendous comparative advantage in biotechnology.
Correct.
What is happening on the ground in terms of, you know, moving further?
I think that in the pharma sector, things are moving. In the biotechnology sector per se, some things are happening. You're seeing in the newspapers that there's a great deal of effort to start venture capitals in biotechnology, but I think it's early days yet. What is also happening is agricultural research on crops that are more in tune with our needs. it's far away from commercialization. It's far away from being actually grown in the field, but that's also happening. What is interesting to see in India is that there is, in fact, a biotechnology policy coming into shape now. And I think that it is a critical time. I think it is important for us to get this policy right. We must decide what India's agenda should be. The fear is that we will become the kind of dumping ground for products developed by other people for which they are seeking markets. And that is the reason why there is a great deal of resistance to BT cotton and also the stuff that the corporations are bringing in. If there is an Indian agenda attempting to fulfill Indian needs in all sectors, whether it is agriculture or it is pharmaceuticals or whether it is agrochemicals, then that will be a well-matched agenda which will make sense. As a last word, I would say that in any science and technology, there is a paramount need to be cautious and careful. Science must not be allowed to become a dangerous implementing tool, which it can be. And I think that that is the reason why we have to proceed more cautiously in this science than in many others which you can stop more easily.
So Suman, what you're saying is we need to proceed cautiously but proactively. And you also seem to suggest that the legislation is going along those lines, but we need to define our agenda much better.
Very clearly.
Thank you very much. With that, we end this program. We'll be back same time, same day next week. Until then, goodbye.